heard those other pieces of music. One of my favorites in the Christian, they both, not contemporary anymore, it's, just, you know, it's been a long time. But yeah, I like that. I like his music. That's true, yeah. Yeah, when I listen to that song and others like it, I feel like I just walked into heaven. It's like, this is different. This is good. Yeah, that's awesome.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Yeah, welcome to Peace Evangelical and Reformed Church. I'm Pastor Marc, and it's already the first Sunday of October. It's amazing how fast the time has gone by. The fall is here, and the colors are beginning to change. And as we begin our first service of the month, we have some announcements to highlight. We have some anniversaries and birthdays in the Peace Church family. Anniversaries this week: Tim and Don Horsewill, Nick and Nicole Evers, Jamie and Chris Wheezy, Tyler and Nicole Banky, David and Kim Hintz, Pat and Lori Gast, Ryan and Jessica Carls, Ryan and Joanna Strzeski, and Nick and Whitney Ziegler. Happy anniversary! And we have some birthdays today in the church. Paul Cummings, Amber Halbach, Carolyn McAtee, Annabella Vanderlinden turned 7 years old, and Fuzzy Weeding, it's their birthdays today. Also this week, Luke Johnson turns 5, Mariah O'Leary turns 16, goes for her driver's license also, and Samantha Bosch. So happy anniversary and happy birthday. You have some other announcements. We've got a couple. This is a tough announcement. Nancy and Dennis Schwalbe gave me a call. Their son Juan Heredia was killed last night in an accident. He was headed back to his car, and he got hit by a car. And they're devastated. Please, let's keep Dennis and Nancy in our prayers as they meet with Peel Hop later today. May the comfort of Jesus be with them as they go through this time. We also need to remember Tom Thiel's family. His mom passed away a few days ago unexpectedly, Joanna Thiel. So we need to keep Tom and Becky and their whole family in our prayers. Also, other announcements to highlight. We still need a teacher for our 2 and 3 year old nursery children. We also need items for Operation Christmas Child shoebox gifts. We need AA batteries, flashlights, bath bar soap, no liquid soaps. Youth group meets next Sunday at 5:30. Church membership class, if you want to become a member of Peace Church, we would love to have you part of our family. And we're having a membership class on November 13th, Sunday at 10:10 a.m. after the morning service. Also, for our missions committee and all who are interested, this Friday, Vita Women's Clinic in Appleton is having an open house from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. You can learn about how all they're doing to help moms and parents and kids in our community. They're one of our missions. Jeannie and I were planning on going to that. If you're interested, let us know. Maybe you can get a group together and go visit one of our missions, the Vita Women's Clinic off of Highway 41 in Appleton. Also, this Friday, I'll be registering members of our church to go down to Aurora, Illinois and help with the Operation Christmas Shoe Boxes as they get sent around the world. That this is the phase where we go through the boxes and we get them ready for final shipment. We're opening it up to both youth and adults. If you want to be part of this ministry, if you could take a day off early in December, probably a Friday, we'll make a trip down to Aurora, Illinois, do the work, stop for supper, and come back all in one day. So Brenda Van Dalwick will share more information about this during a mission moment next week. Do we have any other announcements to highlight? Yes, Kyle.
Consistory meeting Thursday night at 5:30.
Okay, and this concludes our morning announcements. Let us pray. Father, we come before you, and like Peter says in John chapter 6, verses 69 to 71, to whom shall we, where else can we go? You have the words of eternal life. So we go to you for eternal life, for abundant life, for comfort and instruction in the Word of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand together, and we will sing song number 308, I Need No Other Argument, I Need No Other Plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. Number 308. Singing. We'll remain standing for the reciting of the Peace Church Statement of Faith found in the back of the songbook on the left side and also on the screen. We believe that the Bible, consisting of the Old and New Testament, is the only inspired, true, authoritative, written Word of God. We believe that there is one God, eternally existing in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in the deity of Jesus Christ, his virgin birth, his sinless life, his miracles, his atoning death, his resurrection, his right hand of God the Father, and ultimately his personal return in power and glory. We believe in the present ministry of the Holy Spirit, whose indwelling power and fullness enables the Christian to live a godly life in this sinful world. We believe that water baptism and the Lord's Supper are sacraments to be observed by the Church during this present age. However, the shed blood of Jesus Christ, his resurrection, and his abundant grace provide the only basis for the justification and salvation of all who believe. We believe in the sanctity of human life at every stage. We believe in the spiritual unity of all believers in Jesus Christ. We believe in the bodily resurrection of the dead, of the believer to everlasting joy and blessedness with the Lord, of the unbeliever to everlasting conscious punishment. And thank you. You may be seated. The kids can come up and we'll have the children's message. Good to see you. Good to see everybody. That's good to see you guys. No, oh, you're welcome. Today we're talking about faith and prayer, and I just wanted to ask you, who knows what prayer is? What does it mean to pray? Who are we talking to when we pray? Yes. God, that's right. That's what prayer is. Prayer is talking with God. When is it a good time to talk to God? When would it be a good time? Lily?
When you might feel like lonely or something.
When you might feel like what?
Like sad or something.
When you feel sad, yeah, that's a important time to talk to God. Yes?
A good time to talk to God is when you're lonely and sad and lost.
Yeah, when you're lonely and sad and lost, yeah. I think we know instinctively, where else can we go? We go to God. We go to our parents and especially to God. And when else is a good time to pray? When you're joyful. Do you think it's okay to pray all the time? Yeah. I think so. What about in school, right before you take a test? Do you think it's okay to say a prayer to God right before you take your test?
Yeah.
That's right, yeah. And is it okay to pray to God for all the people in Florida recovering from the hurricane? I think so. You know when it is a good time to pray to God? All the time. And you could pray out loud, or you can close your eyes and talk to God in your mind without saying it out loud if you're in a public place. So it's always good to talk to God. And we're able to talk to God because Jesus wants us to. See, he's knocking on the door of our life. He wants you to do that, to talk to him. And you can anytime you want. And at church, we pray together for God to help us. Yes, Thomas.
If you don't pray to God, you won't have his love.
If you don't pray to God, you won't have his love. Well, you might not feel it as much. I think God loves people even when they don't pray, but you really experience it when you do pray. That is right. That's what Psalm 112, verse 9 says, that he scatters abroad his gifts to the poor, his love for everybody. Let us pray. God, I thank you so much that it's always a good time to pray. We pray when we're sad, but we should also thank you when we're happy. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right. So, you can have a fruit by the foot or Twix. All right.
One for Savvy, this one for Keegan.
Okay, one for Savvy, one for Keegan. Okay. 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 Oh, thank you. I got a little return of capital here. Excellent. Our Bible reading this morning comes from Mark chapter 11. We're going to pick up the action in verse 20. In the morning, as they went along, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots. Peter remembered and said to Jesus, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered." "Have faith in God," Jesus answered. "I tell you the truth, if anyone says to this mountain, 'Go throw yourself into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins." This is the inspired, authoritative, inerrant, infallible, written word of God, and may the Lord add his blessing to our study of the word of God today. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for these precious scriptures, and I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be faithful to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. There are certain things that I probably can't do. I can't kick a 60-yard field goal to win a game for the Cleveland Browns. I can't beat LeBron James in a game of one-on-one. I can't jump in the air and touch the ceiling of the church unless we have a very, very tall trampoline. And I can't eat 100 slices of pizza in one day unless the pieces are about this big. And I can't turn back time. But I can do everything God is calling me to do through Christ, who gives me strength. And so can you. One of the reasons why we fail in life at times is because we fail to remember who God is. We fail to remember Psalm 46, verse 1, that he is an ever-present help in times of trouble. We fail to remember Isaiah 41, verse 10, which says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." We forget Joshua 1:9. "Do not be terrified, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." In today's reading, Jesus is teaching the disciples about the importance of putting your faith and reliance and dependence and trust in Almighty God. Today, we're going to look at what faith in God can do for you. But first, we have to set the scene for the narrative. In verses 12 through 19, Jesus carries out two symbolic acts of judgment on Israel. He curses the fig tree and says, "May you never bear fruit again." And he goes into the temple and he drives out the money changers. Verse 20 says, "The following morning, as they went along, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots." One word of judgment from Christ and that tree was dead. The word withered means to be dried up, to be shriveled. We see the word in Mark 4, verse 6, when the farmer sows his seed on the rocky soil and the plant shoots up quickly because the soil is shallow, but the sun scorches the plants and they wither almost immediately. Jesus is saying that's what's happening to the nation of Israel, and that's what's going to happen to anyone and everyone who rejects God and Christ and doesn't grow the fruits of the Spirit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. What a graphic warning those judgments were. And they made quite an impression on the Apostle Peter. Verse 21 says that Peter remembered. And he said to Jesus, "Rabbi, teacher, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered." And then Jesus says, "Have faith in God." Well, have faith in God. Well, what does that have to do with the cursing of the fig tree? What is the significance of Jesus saying, have faith in God, after doing something like that? It almost seems like it's out of context, right? Well, one pastor said, well, Jesus is saying, have faith in God, and you'll be able to carry out destructive miracles of judgment, just like Jesus did. I'm pretty sure that's not right. In Luke 9, verse 54, James and John say to Jesus, Lord, should we call down fire from heaven and consume the Samaritan village that refused to welcome us? And Jesus rebukes them. He says, no, what's the matter with you people? I didn't come here to destroy men's lives. I came to save them, came to help them. Bruce Barden has an interesting interpretation. He says the passage doesn't mean have faith in God and you'll be able to destroy trees just like me. He's saying have faith in God and you won't get destroyed like that fig tree. Well, that was an attractive interpretation at first. And there's some scriptural support for the idea. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 says that Jesus rescues us from the coming wrath. And 1 Peter 1:5 says, by faith we are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that's ready to be revealed in the last time. So theologically, I agree that if we have faith in God, we won't get destroyed like the fig tree was. But I question whether or not that's what Jesus was trying to say here. Don't you think we should read what Jesus says right after this to see if it gives any clarification to what he might be talking about? Let's find out. He says, have faith in God. I tell you the truth. If anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and doesn't doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen, it will be done for him. So he's not saying, have faith in God and you won't get killed like that fig tree. He's saying, have faith in God and like me, you'll be able to do whatever it is that God is calling you to do in life. James Edwards says, mountain-moving faith is a choice to trust in Jesus despite everything to the contrary and to expect from him what cannot be expected from anything else in the world. Now, it's interesting that Jesus says, if anybody says to this mountain, throw yourself into the sea. And so scholars have debated what mountain he's talking about. Most of them say he's talking about the one they're standing on, the Temple Mount. That if you ask God to overthrow the ritualistic, legalistic throne of Judaism, God will do it. But some people say he could have been referring to the mountain just to the south. That's where King Herod's fortress was. So Jesus, in that instance, would be saying, you could ask God to overthrow that mountain, that fortress of darkness that threatens your ministry, and God will do it. We don't know for sure which mountain it is. What we do know is that moving mountains is a metaphor for God moving obstacles that are in the way of accomplishing his purposes. In Zechariah 4, verses 6 through 9, God wants Zerubbabel to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. And verse 7 says, what are you, O mighty mountain? Yet you will be leveled before Zerubbabel. God's not saying he's going to literally change the landscape of Israel so that Zerubbabel can rebuild the temple. He's saying that he's going to level all obstacles and all mountains of opposition that are getting in the way of Zerubbabel doing the will of God. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 2, if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. He's not saying if I have the faith that can literally change the landscape of planet Earth. He's talking about having the faith to change the landscape of your situation, calling on God to alter your circumstances, to alter you so that you can be all that you can be for him. What are the mountains you want God to move in your life? A confirmation student who has to give her speech in front of the church, might feel really frightened. Her fear is this big mountain that's hindering her from going up and doing the best she can. She needs to pray to God to move this mountain of fear out of the way so she could come up and do the best she can for the glory of God. Or maybe somebody has just been called up to play their first varsity basketball game, and they're excited about that because it's what they've always wanted. But they're also filled with fear and doubt because a lot of those kids are older than they are, and they've been playing varsity longer than they have been, and they're nervous about their first time, and their fear and their worry and their doubt is like this big mountain, and they need to pray, Lord, please move this mountain out of the way so I can be all that you can be and I can be the best that I can be on the court when I go out there and play. Lord, I believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Or maybe you have children or grandchildren that have turned away from the Christian faith and have embraced the moral relativism and materialism and atheistic philosophies of their college professors. You wonder, they say such things that are so antithetical to Christian faith, you wonder if they're ever going to come back to God. And when you pray for your kids, you feel like there's this big mountain of doubt and unbelief. Oh, they're so highly educated in these other worldviews, I don't think they're ever going to come back. And that's when you need to say, no, Lord, I refuse to accept that. I believe in what you can do behind the scenes in the lives of my kids and my grandchildren. I believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Move this obstacle of obstinance and unbelief so I can pray to you freely and with power. The Life Application Commentary on Mark says, mountain-moving faith refers to prayers that the disciples would need to pray in order to overcome mountains of opposition to their gospel message. Jesus says, if you do not doubt in your heart, but believe that God will overthrow this mountain of opposition you're facing, he will. And he amplifies that in verse 24. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. That almost sounds like a blank check, doesn't it? Whatever you want, believe that you have it, and you're going to have it. Lord, I pray for $5 million, and I pray for it to all be in 20s and 50s and $100 bills, stacked up nicely and wrapped up in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm claiming Mark 11:24 over my life. Amen. Now, before you take that money to the bank, I just want to ask you a few questions. Yes, God has the power and the desire to respond to the prayers of his people, but would God answer a prayer that would go against his will and his purposes and his plans for his people? Should we want God to give us whatever we want, even if it would hurt us, even if it would hinder us, even if it would distract us and detract us from loving and serving God with all of our hearts? Psalm 37, verse 23 says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. But one of the things that I've been discovering as a Christian for the last 38 years is that the more I get into the Word of God, and the more I pray about things, the more I end up desiring what he desires for my life. That my desires more and more are starting to line up with his desires. When I was younger, maybe my desire was to be rich, or was to be famous, or was to have this car, or have this stereo system. But now my desire is to be close to God. My desire is to be in right relationship with Jesus. My desire is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So yes, Jesus is inviting you to pray, but also trusting the process, God is going to transform you so that you will have the mind of Christ, so that you'll be praying for the things that God desires most for your life. If I knew that having a certain amount of money was going to turn me away from God or have people pounding on my door or asking for handouts or threatening my life, I don't think I'd want that. And I think God knows that that wouldn't be best. And let's remember the context of this open invitation from Jesus. The context is Christ's ministry. It was Jesus' faith in God that gave him the power to be able to speak those words of judgment on the fig tree. It was Jesus' faith in God that gave him the grace and the strength to go into the temple amongst all those people and drive out the money changers. And so Jesus is saying, if you ask for anything to help you do what God is calling you to do, no matter how crazy difficult it might seem, no matter how far-fetched it might seem, God will respond to that and help you do your ministry. It will be yours as long as it is consistent with God's character and God's will and God's best for your life. Warren Wiersbe says we should not interpret Mark 11:24 to mean if you pray hard enough and really believe, God will give you whatever you want no matter what. That kind of faith is not faith in God. That is faith in faith. The Life Application Commentary says this verse was not a guarantee that the disciples could get anything they wanted simply by asking Jesus, treating him like a soda machine. God does not grant requests that will hurt people or that will violate his own nature and holy character. Jesus' statement was not a blank check. To be fulfilled, requests made to God in prayer must be in harmony with the principles of his kingdom. 1 John 5:14 says, this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. You see, we can't just take one slice of theology from one fragment of a verse and build a whole system of self-actualization. We have to look at the entire written revelation, the entire context of the Bible, and that seems to suggest that the prayer you make needs to be in accordance with his will. That is the key. Going to God and asking, and if it's in his will, then it's a yes. Yeah. But there's another qualifier in verse 25. It says, when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. So not only should you have mountain-moving faith in God to give you the strength to do whatever he's calling you to do, you should also have faith in God to move the biggest mountains of them all, the mountain of unforgiveness and grudges and bitterness from your life. C.S. Lewis says forgiveness seems like a lovely idea until there's somebody that you need to forgive. That is so true. It's easy to tell someone that they need to forgive and let go until you're the guy that needs to forgive and let go, right? There have been times in my life, I'm sure it's the same with you, there have been times in my life when I have been so upset with somebody, I wasn't 100% sure I was going to be able to forgive him. I didn't know if I wanted to forgive him. But you know what? After a few days, I was so bitter and embattled and belabored and edgy that I didn't like myself anymore. I didn't like feeling my heart pound within my chest whenever I thought about the situation. I didn't feel happy about getting worked up every time my mind went there, and it went there a lot. And the worst part was that it was coming between me and God. It was like this big mountain of anger that was separating me from him, so my prayers weren't making it past the mountain. I was miserable. So finally I said, well, you know what? Even though I feel like I was done wrong, it's not right, it's not good for me to feel this way. So I went to God. I said, Lord, I'm holding a grudge. I didn't think that as a Christian I'd be doing that anymore, but I did it. And I don't like what it's doing to me. And I apologize, God. I am wrong. I choose to leave all of this junk here at the foot of the cross. Even if the person doesn't want to be my friend anymore, even if they don't want to apologize, I'm not going to let the situation live rent-free. What other people think of me will have no bearing on how much I love them and pray for them. And so, God, I'm giving this to you in Jesus' name, amen. But you know what? I couldn't just pray that prayer one time because I started thinking about it, you get mad again, then you got to pray it all over. You know, it's sort of like taking an antibiotic. Can you take an antibiotic just once and expect the infection to go away? It'll come back and maybe stronger. You got to take that antibiotic until it's run its course. And that's kind of the way it is with prayer over bitterness and unforgiveness. You got to take it to God in prayer every day until it's run its course, till that infection is out of you, until you're free to say, praise you, Jesus, I'm so glad that I am free at last from this situation. Put your faith in God through Jesus Christ, and he will help you do whatever it is he's calling you to do. If you're a new Sunday school teacher, you can say, God, I stepped out on faith to do this ministry, but I've never been a Sunday school teacher before. I feel like there's this big mountain of doubt and lack of belief in myself, and it's hindering me and keeping me from feeling confident in the classroom. So, God, I'm coming to you for grace and strength. I don't want this mountain in my life. Get this mountain out of here in the name of Jesus, and help me to do all I can do to be the best teacher I can be, to read scripture and be prepared, and just help me to do the best I can for your glory. Or you can say, Lord, I want to share my faith with my friends at work, but I'm staring at this big mountain of fear. Fear that my relationship with my coworkers is going to change. Fear that they're going to think I'm judging them. Fear that they're going to think I'm better than they are. Fear that I'm going to end up feeling like I'm all by myself at work. But Lord, I don't want this mountain in my life. Level this mountain. Move this mountain and throw it into the sea in the name of Jesus. Give me the courage to share how much you mean to me and what you've been doing in my life to help me become more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. So what can faith in God do for you? It can help you do whatever God is calling you to do through Christ who gives you strength. It proves that God can minister powerfully through ordinary people. And if you're not a Christian, you can put your faith in God today. Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose again, and he's knocking on the door of your life. And if you open the door and let him in, that is an act of faith, and he will forgive your sins and give you eternal life and abundant life and the grace and the strength to do whatever he's calling you to do for him in church and in the world. I invite you to the one who gave his life for you. Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Amen. Thank you. And now we'll sing number 310. I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able. beautiful song. This is the time of the service where we offer our joys and concerns. We need to remember the families of Nancy and Dennis Schwalbe as they grieve Juan Heredia's death. We need to pray for the family of Lori Neusehart. We had her funeral here on Thursday afternoon and evening. May the grace of Jesus comfort them and surround them. We need to remember Tom Thiel's family as they prepare to commemorate and celebrate and remember their mom's life. Need to also keep Lori Krieger in our prayers as she battles ALS. Need to remember Jeannie in prayer. She was fighting an infection and went in, and she also found out she's got iron deficiency, anemia, and very elevated vitamin B12 levels. So they're going to do some tests to try to figure that stuff out. So we're praying for a good word, good news, and help from on high in the name of Jesus. Also, we want to pray for Florida for rescue and recovery from Hurricane Ian. And Tammy Gillig, I'm requesting prayer, wasn't feeling well today. And also her mom, Lois Pruitt, who fractured her hand and is hurting. So that's what I've got. Do we have any other joys and concerns? Yes, Judy. Amen.
And all the prayers for all the prayer requests from the church and all our friends and family members.
Oh, thank you very much. And yes, Mike.
Neighbor Dan is going to have a bypass surgery on Tuesday.
Okay, I will. To that. Yes, Joan. Okay, yeah, we will. We'll pray for the pro-life advocates. I was thinking about that. We're going to this Vita Women's Clinic. We should be praying for us too, you know, but yeah, definitely. We'll pray for all those who are being persecuted for their stand. Okay. Yes, Brad.
My brother-in-law, John Kramer, had a bad fall.
Okay. We'll pray for John. Yeah, Stephanie.
Emma and the NMU crew is at a retreat this weekend, so traveling mercies, they get home safely.
Okay, we'll pray for Emma. Okay. Yes, Brenda. Oh, boy.
And I heard Sandy this morning say that Russ is doing well.
Yeah, praise the Lord for that. And this is one of your girls, or? Okay, we'll pray for her. Yes, Jennifer. Oh, my heart goes out to you guys. That is so hard. Okay. Let us pray. Lord, I'm thinking about Revelation chapter 8, where the angels are bringing this really big basket of incense before the throne of God. And we find out in the text that that represents all the prayers that people are praying. And I feel like we got a big basket of them right here. And we want to bring them before you. We pray comfort for the families of Nancy and Dennis Schwalbe as they grieve Juan Heredia's death. The family of Lori Neusehart, may the comfort and peace of Jesus be with them. For Lori Krieger, for remission and healing. For Jeannie Axelrod, for good words of encouragement from the doctor and instructions for the future. For Florida, as the rescue and recovery from Hurricane Ian continues. For Tom Thiel's family, as they grieve Tom's mom's passing. for Lois Pruitt for healing from her fractured hand and relief from the pain. We rejoice that Judy and George have recovered from not feeling well. George had a trip to the ER for dehydration. We're glad he's better. Judy wasn't feeling well. We're glad that she's on the mend, that she continues to heal. Mike Brown's neighbor Dan's having bypass surgery this week. We pray the doctor does an awesome job and that this brings healing and health to Dan's body. We rejoice that Sandy Meyer's son Russell is doing well following surgery. May his healing continue. We agree with Joan Holshue in prayer for pro-life advocates. We've been hearing stories about them being attacked. And so, Lord, I also pray for their safety and for the safety of the Vita Women's Clinic in Appleton. We're living in very turbulent times. We pray for John Kramer, Brad Hernke's and Steve Hernke's brother-in-law who fell and got hurt. May there be healing for him. For Bryce Bartle and Jennifer and Troy, they have to put their dog down later today. And we all know what that's like and how heart-achingly difficult that is. May the comfort of Jesus surround them and may they know that they are loved. We pray for Emma Bartles going on a youth crew trip with friends. Please keep her and all her friends safe back and forth from school. We also pray for one of Brenda's clients who has cellulitis and it's in the bone. We pray, God, that they'll be able to stop that infection so that she won't lose her limb. And we pray for all the unspoken requests. We pray, Lord, for all those who are leaders, that you would lead and guide them. We pray those in medical ministry, for law enforcement and our military, watch over those who watch over us. And God, we thank you for Jesus, who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers come forward, we'll take up the morning offering. Thank you. Please rise. Father, thank you for these gifts and help us to use them wisely for the work of God and the work of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. And thank you. You may be seated. At Peace Church, we have communion the first Sunday of the month and on holidays. It works out to roughly 16 times a year or something like that, and we practice open communion. If you believe in Christ, you're invited to partake with us. This table is open to all who confess Jesus as the Christ and seek to follow Christ's way. In Luke's gospel, we read that Jesus, at the table with two of the disciples, took bread and blessed and broke it. When he gave it to them, their eyes were open, and they recognized the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. In the Acts of the Apostles, we read that the church was gathered often in the homes of believers. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Jesus, the bread of life, we gather at your table to know you in the breaking of the bread. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give God thanks and praise.
Holy God, we praise and bless you for creation, for the life you have given to us, and for your abiding love. We thank you for revealing your will for us, in the giving of the law, and in the preaching of the prophets. We thank you especially that in the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, born of Mary, to live in our midst, share in our suffering, and to accept the pain of death, taking upon himself the sin of us all. We rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave, you raised Christ with power to be the Lord of the universe. You gave to us the assurance of eternal life with you.
Celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit and the institution of the Church, by which your work may be done in the world. With the faithful in every place and time, we praise with joy your holy name. Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory. O God, most high, we remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took bread and gave thanks. And he broke the bread and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Consecrate, therefore, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine, and bless us that receive them at this table, that we may offer you our faith and praise, that we may be united with Christ and with one another, and that we may continue faithful in all things.
In the strength Christ gives us, we offer ourselves to you, eternal God, and give thanks that you have called us to serve you.
Amen. Come, for all things are ready. This is the body of Christ, broken for you. Let us partake together. This is the blood of Christ poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Let us partake together. Let us pray the prayer of thanksgiving that's found on the screen. We thank you, Almighty, everlasting God, for inviting us to this table where we have known the presence of Christ and have received all of Christ's gifts. Strengthen our faith. Increase our love for one another, and help us to praise you with our lives. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Thank you. Okay, for those of you watching with us online, thank you for worshiping with us. I want to leave you with a word of encouragement. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. And now let us stand for the closing song of the service, Blessed Be the Name. Blessed Be Your Name by Tree 63.